Hello there, everybody. How are we doing today? Pastor Rick here, New Life, in the New Life office, that is. Greeting you in the name of Jesus. Let's see who's on here today. We have seven people so far. Tony,
Hello,
Jason.
There,
oops.
How are we doing today?
Little delayed thing there on my phone. Tony, Jason, Dolores, Pastor Bill, and a few others that are on there. So that's good. Good to see you. Oops. I just lost you for a second. Okay. Well, let's open up with a word of prayer. And then I want to sing a song today. I'll lead you in a song. I think you might know it. If you need to get lyrics, if you can use your phone or your laptop or whatever, the name of the song is Wonderful, Merciful Savior. It's been on my heart for the last couple of days, so I figured I'd sing it. I haven't sung it in a long time. So we'll worship the Lord with that song in just a minute. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. We want to lift up Bethany Nado, that's still having some serious, and I mean serious, life-threatening complications with her pneumonia and whatever's going on with her, and Joanne Feldman as well. So let's go to the Lord. Father, thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Lord, that, Lord, you're never too busy. As we used to sing a long time ago, the main line is always available. Your line is always open. And so, Lord, today we come before you and we want to talk to you. We want to praise you. We want to beseech you, Lord, on behalf of some of our people as well. But, Lord, bless our time together. Thank you for those that are coming on. Bless Tuesday Talk. Let it accomplish what you want it to accomplish today. Father, we do pray for Bethany Nado in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord God, bring your healing to her. Bring your healing touch to her. And use the doctors and medical team. Thank you for all their expertise. They are wonderful. But, Lord, Bethany needs more than what they could give her. We pray, Lord, that your unmistakable touch of healing will be upon her lungs, her blood, her body, her temperature, her breathing, everything, Lord. Just touch her and bring healing. And may your blessing be upon her husband, Joe, her little baby, Silas, upon her mom and dad, and her brother and sister and their families as well. So, Lord, we just pray for a miracle in that situation. We pray, Lord, for Joanne Feldman. Once again, Lord, healing and strength to her in the name and authority of Jesus Christ. Lord, let her be well. Let our ministry, our visitation team be of help to her. And Lord, just bless that whole situation. Lord, anyone dealing with COVID, we pray for healing. Anyone dealing with just feeling blah and overwhelmed, we pray for your deliverance. So Lord, use this time to speak to our hearts. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. All righty. All right. Hey, Rob LaFountain, God bless you. Eva, yeah, Eva, I hope you're doing okay. We miss you as well, but hope all is well with you. This morning, as I got on Facebook, I was drawn to Tony Cascina's post, which I guess was it wasn't today, it was from a while ago that I missed, but on Tony's wall are mounted four guitars. And they're all, you know, a bass, an electric, a classical, and an acoustic on his wall, you know, hanging like this, if you could picture it, you know, like before. It really looked good, but it made me think about my guitar, and it made me think about how I miss our Sunday nights. I would lead worship every Sunday night. I would lead worship every Wednesday night with kind of like a skeleton worship team. Because it was a weeknight. Sunday morning was the big thing. But now that we're doing the live streams on Sunday night and Wednesday, I'm not leading worship. And I realized I missed that time of worshiping. And anyway, last year and the year before, we started singing this song, Wonderful, Merciful Savior. It's called Wonderful, Merciful Savior. And I remember the first couple of times that we sang it, we must have sang it for like 10 minutes, 12 minutes straight to get it, you know, and it was so beautiful. I remember Sheldon at one point came up to me after one of those nights when we sang it for like 10 minutes. He said, well, I think we got it now, you know. But it was so fresh on our hearts and so ministering to the Lord and ministering to us. I couldn't stop singing it. So anyway, if you need the words, you could probably get them online, but I don't know how to go from there if you're on here. So just do the best you can. I'm going to turn this down a little bit and hear this like that so you can see the guitar more. All right. Is that coming across okay? Somebody tell me. Is that coming across pretty good? I was going to finger pick it, but with the pick, it's a little more crispy. Hey, Pam, Pamela, Gigi's on. That's great. Okay, here we go.
Merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a Lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Somebody say amen. Oh, Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit, we long to embrace. Offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hung. Oh, our hearts always hungered for. Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. We're gonna sing that verse again. Listen to the words if you don't know them. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord for a worship song, right? Let me put this down over here. Alrighty. Hey, Mom. Mom, did you hear that song? You may know that song, actually. Anyway, welcome Margaret Amendola from Rye, New York. All right. Very good. Well, so good to have you all on here today. Let's see if I missed anyone. Rob, good to see you, Rob, out there. Out Ohio, right, Rob? Forgive me, I keep forgetting. I don't know why, but I think it's Ohio. Gail Zanke in Tennessee. Yeah, you know, Friday night is our annual business meeting. And let me fix this back up here. And, you know, getting ready with all those reports. I was mentioning about the live streams that have incorporated several people from, Illinois. Oh, forgive me, Rob. Several people from other states, you know. Of course, Rob is in Illinois. Gail is in Tennessee. Tony's in New Jersey. We have some other friends from Florida. We have some from Virginia. We have some from Oregon when they could make it. But anyway, this live stream is pretty amazing. You know, we're able to reach out. So anyway, good to have you all here. Mom, you did hear this song. Well, good. I hope you liked it. Okay, so this morning in my little devotional book here, again, this is by John Bailey, an old, you know, classic prayer book, actually. John Bailey, this was first published, 1936. James is in Bradford. So we're reaching near and far, let's put it that way. But I wanted to read this prayer to you and let it be our prayer as we get started here today, too. So this is the morning prayer for this day. God, hey, Sandy, God bless you. God of my forefathers, I cry unto thee. Thou hast been the refuge of good and wise men in every generation. When history began, thou wert the first enlightener of men's minds. And thine was the spirit that first led them out of their brutish estate and made them men. Through all the ages, thou hast been the Lord and giver of life, the source of all knowledge, and the fountain of all goodness. The patriarchs trusted thee and were not put to shame. The prophets sought thee, and thou didst commit thy word to their lips. The psalmist rejoiced in thee, and thou wert present in their song. The apostles waited upon thee, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. The martyrs called upon thee, and thou wert with them in the midst of the flame. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all of his trouble. O thou who wast and art to come, I thank thee that this Christian way whereupon I walk is no untried or unchartered road, but a road beaten hard by the footsteps of saints, apostles, prophets, and martyrs. I thank thee for the finger post and the danger signals with which it is marked at every turning, and which may be known to me through the study of the Bible and of all history and of all the great literature of the world. Beyond all, I give thee devout and humble thanks for the great gift of Jesus Christ, the pioneer of our faith. I praise thee that thou hast caused me to be born in an age and in a land which has known his name, and that I am not called upon to face any temptation or trial which he did not first endure. Forbid it, Holy Lord, that I should fail to profit by these great memories of the ages that are gone by, or to enter into the glorious inheritance which thou hast prepared for me through Jesus Christ, my Lord. Amen. Amen. I love that. It's a great devotional. So this is something that I do every morning, actually, and evening. There's a morning prayer and an evening prayer. And then I have my own little prayer that I do after that, too. So that's not all my prayer, but that gets me going in the right direction. So anyway, how's everyone doing? Good to see you all here. We have, 12 people on, so that's great. Praise the Lord for that. Today's Tuesday. So tomorrow we have a Zoom meeting at 12 o'clock with Reverend Bill Unger. I'll send out that Zoom info. On tomorrow night is our Wednesday night Bible study. Did we finish chapter 12 of Romans? I don't think we did. But hopefully we'll finish up Romans 12 and get into Romans 13 on Wednesday night. Then Thursday is our men's Zoom meeting. By the way, hey, Doreen, God bless you. How are you and Billy doing? We've been missing you. Hope you're okay. All the Zoom meetings that we do, Wednesday afternoon, the Brotherhood, Sisterhood meetings, all missions meetings, they all have the same ID and the same password. So whatever that is, I can't, have it written down. But whatever that is the same for all of our Zoom meetings. So we did it that way on purpose so that we wouldn't forget. So if you could find one of them through email or on Facebook, they're for everything. I will get that to you all again. So Pamela said, we didn't quite finish chapter 12. Yeah, it was right towards the end of that. So we'll wrap it up tomorrow and get into chapter 13. Friday, of course, is our annual business meeting at 6:30. We're going to have an abbreviated meeting, just some things to go over with our church members. Everyone's invited to come, whether you're a member or not. But we do have the limitation of 38 or so people. 38 people plus staff, so whatever that number comes to. But anyway, that's Friday. So we have a pretty busy week going on Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night. And then, of course, Sunday will come and we'll be the ministry at the last Sunday of January already. Can you believe that? That is amazing that January is almost behind us already. So anyway, I found some scripture references here. And I'm not sure when this was made up for. I made it up myself. I think we used this either last Tuesday or last Thursday with Ella, when Ella was with me on Thursday. Yes, members are highly encouraged to attend Friday night. No coffee and fellowship. We'll get right to it. So anyway, everyone's invited. I wanted to share some of these scriptures about being strong and being encouraged and not being fearful of what's happening. At our pastor's devotion, our pastor's Zoom meeting this morning with some of the local pastors, we were sharing that it seems like a lot of churches, a lot of ministries are experiencing people that are a little edgy, a little worried, a little rough because they're upset, they're nervous, they're unsure of what's happening with life, with work, with finances, with church, with everything. And so it does make people edgy. But I really think this is a time for the church to kind of step back and kind of regroup a little bit, get our bearings, get our footing in the Lord, and let's just ride out this storm that we're in. It'll pass. This is going to pass. We do need to pray for our new president. Let's see now. This will bring up a little touchy subject, I'm sure, for some people, but some of the things that Christians were afraid of happening have basically happened, which are issues regarding abortion, issues regarding the security of our borders, and that pipeline out west, which seemed to be a good deal for employing thousands of people, it seems. And now that pipeline has come to a halt. And so these are some of the issues we were concerned about. So we need to pray for our country, for our president, for the administration, that God is doing something in the midst of all this, regardless of what happens to our nation. The church has got to be focused and grounded and steadfast. On Sunday, I shared a message entitled Clear Vision or New Vision for New Life in 2021. It was actually a three-part sermon. Finished it up last Sunday. But last Sunday were the three areas that Christians suffer. Because it says in 1 Peter 5:10 that the Lord who called us, the Lord who found us, pours into us, called us to eternity, will perfect and establish and strengthen and settle us after we suffered a while. So we got into the whole concept of what does that mean? What kind of suffering do we do? Well, part of living in this country and living as a Christian person that's has principles that are contrary to the flow of our nation, we're in a position where we are suffering. And with the current administration, and this is one of the things everyone was concerned about, there are probably some things that were done and are going to be done, which will further enhance the disparity between Christian values and secular values. And I realize that our country is a diverse country. Everyone is not Christian. We're not like a theocracy. We're a democracy. My father always taught me that America is a place of freedom of religion and freedom of speech. And everyone that has anything to say or however they want to believe must be granted the right to do that. And that's true. It's just that our country was founded and grounded on Christian principles. And now we seem to have, because of the great diversity, we seem to be kind of embracing everybody and everything, trying to appease everyone. And it's a difficult situation to be in, but we need to pray for, as a fact, why don't we pray right now? Can we do that? Scripture says to pray for those in authority, whether they're Democratic or Republican or independent or whatever they are, pertaining to America, pray for those in authority. So as we pray for President Trump, we now pray for President Biden and the new administration. Let's pray. Father, we do pray for our new president and the administration, Lord. We pray for godliness. We pray for spiritual guidance and just an openness on everyone's part that are in high positions of leadership in our country to sense the presence of God. We pray, Lord, for your Holy Spirit to lead and direct the thoughts and the intents of the heart of people that make decisions. And Lord, that we as a nation would be a nation that fears you, first of all, that loves and respects you and your word. And Lord, we'll embrace everybody, but we do pray that America would be a godly nation because we're a nation that loves the Lord and serves the Lord through Jesus Christ. Lord, it's a complex matter in this free culture that we live in. But Lord, you know all that. We just pray your blessing upon our nation, upon our leadership, that we, as the scripture says in 1 Timothy 2, that we may live peaceful lives, that we may live in a situation where there's peace and rest and harmony. But Lord, let your Holy Spirit be released and bless this new administration. In Christ's name, I pray. Amen. All right. Thank you for your comments there. Yeah. So Sunday, we did show a little video from Pregnancy Care Center here in Haverhill regarding the abortion issues we're dealing with. That ministry helps women make decisions that line up with God's word. And I think through their ministry, countless thousands of babies have been born and provided for. That's very important. It's not just a matter of pre-birth. You know, it's a matter of being pro-life after the baby's born, giving help and assistance and ministering to the mothers and fathers of these dear children. So hopefully this is a ministry that we'll continue to support as we get going in this new year. But anyway, I wanted to share a few scriptures with you. So let's see. I'm going to take a stab here and go to Psalm number 28. Psalm 28 in verse 7. Let's see where we are here with this. Oh, yeah, I think maybe I did share this on Thursday, but... Yeah, I hear you, Tony. It seems that we not only have a pandemic, but also an epidemic of fear. Yep. We know that God did not give us a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. Absolutely. Paul wrote that to Timothy. You know, and I had COVID. Several of our people had COVID. I always tell people, I was sick. I was definitely sick. I was waiting for something more drastic to happen, though, but it didn't, thankfully. So COVID, I think what's underplayed are the number of people that have COVID and recover from it. Several in our church have it now. One family has it pretty severely, but they also have other health complications. So I know that is an issue. Hey, Juanita, just thinking about you, Juanita, with you and your husband having COVID. Millie Cobbett, God bless you. I know Pastor Bill talked to you earlier, I think yesterday that was, regarding some of the things you were concerned about. So anyway, Psalm 28 in verse 7. Thank you, Pamela, for putting it on the comment section. The Lord is my strength and my shield. Somebody, take that home. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I will praise him. You know, what a great scripture. But the Lord is my strength and my shield. He's my buckler. He protects me from the attack of the enemy, whether it's physical, spiritual, or emotional. Emotional is really big too. And it says, my heart trusted in him. Therefore I am helped. So there's this idea of the Lord, we putting our faith and trust in the Lord, him responding to that and helping us. Thus I am helped as I put my faith and trust in the Lord. Therefore my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I will praise him. Hallelujah. So many of you know my dilemma with my car. Let me just give you the latest update. It's at the continuing saga, but we're on an uphill. We're on a good spot right now. So my car, the brakes, the brake lights would go on when I wasn't touching the brake pedal. Got pulled over last year. Someone called the police on me, said I was driving erratically. Got pulled over on a highway in Connecticut going to New York, and the state trooper says, "Have you been drinking?" I said, "Officer, no, I have not been drinking. Are you doing any?" "No." And Pamela's there with me, and I'm saying, "What's the problem?" He said, "Someone called us and said you were driving erratically and putting your brake lights on every 10 seconds or something." I said, "No, I'm going to New York. I'm fine." I said, "But you know what? I did wonder about my brake lights because I don't know how I knew, but I felt like they were coming on at the wrong time or staying on too long. I don't know how I knew that, but I did know that." I said, "But I think that's the problem. I'll get it taken care of." Anyway, he let me go, no ticket. So I got home, got it fixed. It was a sensor. So that was good for about a year. Then something else happened, and the brake lights were not going on again. So I got another sensor. My mechanic did it a couple of times. He did it like three or four times. It kept burning out, so I brought it to the dealer. The dealer fixed it for a hefty price, I may add. But you know on the brake lights, there's two in the back and one little light in the middle of your windshield? Well, when I took it there, all three lights worked, but when I got it back, the middle light didn't work. So I said, "Oh, I'm going to bring it back to my mechanic. He'll fix the middle light." He fixed the middle light, but then the same thing happened all over again when I'm sitting in the car and the brake lights went on all by themselves. So I said, "Ay, ay, ay, I'm going to bring it back to the dealer, let them deal with it." So I bring it back there yesterday, and I tell them what the problem was. It's there all day long, and whatever they did, it didn't happen. The brake lights worked fine. All three of them, they didn't go on. They only worked when you stepped on the brake, and it was great. Everything was good. So I took it home. I said, how much do I owe you for that? He goes, well, since we didn't do anything, we're not going to charge you anything. I said, oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So anyway, I got the car back, and the brake lights are working. But I am trusting the Lord with my vehicle. I really am. Just like I'm trusting the Lord with my wallet situation. You know, I lost my wallet and never found it. It's been over a week. That thing is long gone, I think. I don't know where in the world it is. The Lord knows where it is. But I got my new credit cards. I got my new license. I got my new Medicare cards coming. And everything's all right. I'm okay with that. But anyway, let me read this again. Psalm 28:7. The Lord is my strength and my shield. Can I just say something? Otherwise, we would go crazy with all the stuff that happens to us in the course of a given day. But the Lord is my strength and my shield. I'm not functioning on my own strength. He's my strength. He's my protector. He's my shield. My heart trusted in him. My heart. I give you my heart, oh God. I give you my life. I give you my problems. But my heart trusted in him. I have faith in God. And because of that, he helps me. The Holy Spirit, he helps me. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices. Hallelujah. And with my song, I will praise him. I think Tony said something about a song. Praise him with your song. Yeah, and so we sang that song today. Wonderful, merciful Savior. Hallelujah. What a good God he is. So, how about a new wallet? Yeah, I'm going to have to get a new wallet. That's a little cheaper than a new car. Jason says, my car is possessed. I thought of that. yeah, come lay hands on my car. You know what? If the thing never gives me any more trouble, I don't know. Electronics does weird things to a vehicle. I know that. Get a GPS chip for your wallet and your keys. Yeah, you know, maybe. Maybe. Anyway, I know I'm not the only one with stuff going on. I think about our dear brother Joe Nato. You know, his wife Bethany is in the hospital, 28 years old, just had a baby 5 months ago. She's been in a coma for over, what did they say, 10 days? I forget what they said, but since last Monday, I think it was. My goodness, in a medically induced coma. Because she's not responding well, she has pneumonia, she has lung problems, and on a ventilator, her fever, it's just, man. So, Joe Nato, let the Lord be your strength and your shield. You know, the Bistany family, Joanne Feldman, same thing, with all these health issues with Joanne. John Eastman, Sandy Whitney, I understand you have some health issues going on right now. Amen to that, Rob. I think you're on to something there. but all these issues, you know, issues of life. You know, it reminds me of a story. It's 12:30 already. Oh, my goodness. I was counseling with a man probably close to 20 years ago to this guy. We're at a different location at that time. And we're talking, and I had this guy pegged for being a lot older than me. Just by the way he looked. He looked rugged and raggedy. He was telling me his life story. I said, listen, man. I said, what happened? What happened to you? What happened? Well, first of all, I asked him how old he was. We were the same age. We were the same. I said, hey, what happened? He looked at me dead in the eye. He said, what happened? He said, life happened. I'll never forget that. Life happened. It's nothing he did in particular. Maybe he made some bad choices. I'm not really sure, but Doreen, I hear you with your daughter. That's another major burden to carry, your daughter. Any news on your daughter, by the way? I haven't talked to you in a while. You know, last we heard, she was in the hospital in a coma on a ventilator. These are issues. You know, and here you never know. Like when you meet somebody, when you talk to someone. Maybe they're acting a little funny. Maybe they're acting a little preoccupied. Can I just say something? Can we give each other a break? We don't know what everyone's dealing with. You know, someone may make... In fact, I've had people come up to me and say, Hey, Pastor Rick, what's the matter? You know, I don't think anything's the matter, but, you know, in the back of my mind, or who knows what, but people could read it on me. And so we need to just lighten up and, you know, be respectful to people and pray for one another. We really need to be praying for one another. Okay, Doreen, well, we're still praying. Let me read you another scripture, Psalm 34. Jason says to keep it going, so I'll keep it going for another few minutes. Psalm 34, verse 18. Oh, I read the wrong verse by mistake, but it's worth reading. Psalm 35, verses 17 and 18. Look at Psalm 35, verse 17. Lord, how long will you look on? In other words, Lord, how long will you look at what's happening to me? And it says, rescue me from their destructions. Lord, how long are you going to watch? We need some action here. My precious... rescue me from their destructions, my precious life. Rescue my precious life from the lions. You know, I don't know if he's speaking figuratively or really real here. But I will give you thanks in the great assembly. I will praise you among many people. Oh, what a lesson from David. In spite of waiting on the Lord and being, you know, worried, I will praise you anyway. My focus is on you. Just like when David went out in battle, you know the story of Ziklag. He left the wives and the children at the camp. He and his army went out to fight the Philistines, I believe it was. And he came back, and another army came and stole the wives and children and demolished the camp. And on top of that, his own army turned against him. And David was like, oh, gee, what, you know. But it says David strengthened himself in the Lord. He put on his ephod. He put on his worship clothes. And in spite of all of that, the wives were gone, the kids were gone, everything was gone. The place was demolished, and his own army turned on him. Instead of David getting in the flesh and getting crazy, he put on his ephod and began to worship God. And in his worshiping, he began to pray and cry out to God, Lord, what should I do? Should I go try to get the wives and kids and all my belongings, should I go get? And the Lord said, yes, go take back what the enemy has stolen from you. And he rallied the troops, and he and his army went back, and they devastated that army, got all the wives and kids and belongings, and went on their way. But all to say that in the midst of our trial, and I know we have trials, someone had said on Sunday that they were discouraged about church because, you know, we have these limitations. So only 38 or so people can come at a time. We showed a picture last Sunday morning of church attendance last January 2020. The place was packed. Worship was jumping. Worship was happening. And you just got the sense of, wow, God is in this place. You know, God's moving. Had the prayer team up there. I could tell the prayer team was in place. Just to remind everyone that, you know, having 28 people is not the norm. I'm not complaining. I'm not complaining at all, because you have 28 there. You have 28 or so at second service. Plus you have 35 or 40 people on live stream, and maybe a couple of, you know, that live stream represents maybe 1 to 3 or 4 or 5 people. So you do the math, and there's quite a large number of people. But all that to say, I can't afford to be discouraged where we're at. I've got to be prayed up. I've got to be positive. I've got to be, you know, got to be strong. And we all do. We all do. We're going through something. It's a pandemic. It'll be written down in history books that we went through this. This is like almost like the Great Depression. Not as bad as that. I'm not saying that. But it's bad as far as the number of deaths in our country attributed to COVID is like over 300,000, I think it is. Or is it 400? I forget. I lost track. But just, man, it'll go down in the record books. But we as the church, we've got to maintain perspective. Let me go back to 34:18, because this is what I wanted to share in the first place. But 34:18, the Lord is near to those. Let me go to 17. 34:17 and 18. The righteous cry out. That's us. We are the righteousness of Christ. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to those who have a broken heart and save such as have a contrite spirit. Yeah. Millie, you're right about that. You're right about that. We try to call, we call quite a few people here from the office, but we need that body ministry going on, because I'll tell you what, one pastor and one associate pastor, I know Pamela has called some people, and Stacy calls some of the ladies too, but it's hard to get everybody, my goodness. And you know what happens when someone's doing relatively well, they sometimes they tend to get neglected because, well, they're doing okay. It's like what is that saying? The squeaky wheel gets the oil. The ones that are, you know, letting us know what's going on, they do get the attention because, well, that we know what's going on. But anyway, all that to say, our strength comes from God. God will use the church to reach out and help everybody, and we as a church, we're doing the best we can with that. I think live stream like this right now is really important and helpful. The Greece, I think our Zoom meetings are helpful where we can actually see each other. I think our in-person meetings are good. By the way, I think this Sunday we're going to remove that plexiglass shield. I'm still waiting to hear from Massachusetts Family Institute regarding some of the restrictions being lifted. But that was never a mandate. That was our own idea to keep people safe and comfortable. But the speaker from our church is so far away from anyone that I don't think it matters anymore about that plexiglass thing. I know James will be happy about that because there's always a reflection in the videotaping of that. But anyway, I don't know. I'm into this now. Let's read one more, and then we're gonna pray. Psalm 55, in verse 22. Notice a lot of these are from Psalms. 55:22. Oh yeah. 55:22. And speaking of the Psalms, a lot of these Psalms were birthed out of angst and anguish. Many of the Psalms, if you read them carefully, David begins with a lot of anxiety and angst and why, and almost being angry. And then he resolves it all by the end. So it's like a kind of like a format. As we praise God and talk, as we pray to God and praise God, our anxiety turns into trust and faith in the Lord. So anyway, Psalm 55:22, cast your burden on the Lord. Somebody give me an amen. Pray. Tell the Lord how you feel. Tell the Lord what's going on. And he will sustain you. He shall sustain you. As you cast your burden on him, he will sustain you. He shall never permit the righteous to be shaken, meaning to the point that we leave God or whatever. So our trials come only to make us stronger. But as we go through trials, we cry out. He sustains us. We grow and develop as a result of that. Last Sunday's sermon. And here we are in the midst of a pandemic, amidst of a crazy election year and political season. Out west, they're still having riots and protests. You know, our country is so strange right now that the protests are still happening, even though we have a new administration. And I'm wondering, what does everyone want? I mean, I don't get that. Why are people still protesting if we have a new administration? I thought that was the issue at hand, but maybe not. I need to get caught up on what's happening out in Oregon and I think Washington State. Hey, Jackie, God bless you. Anyway, we're going to have to wrap it up. We're going way too long today. I don't mean to keep you, but just want to remind you, Wednesday at 12 o'clock, a Zoom meeting. You'll be blessed by Bill Unger. The teaching is always on point. Zoom meeting, I'll give you that info. Oh, Tony. Tony, you're a brother after my own heart. You're a music guy. You're a worshiper, Tony. I'll gladly sing that song if everyone can join in with me. I won't know if you're singing, but it would be nice. Yeah, we'll sing that on the way out, as we go out. Okay, so anyway, let me make sure I got everything. Got my guitar, got my capo on the second fret. Down so everyone can see the guitar in action. All right. Dear Father, Lord, thank you for today. Thank you, Lord, for just your blessing, your presence. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, oh God. Okay, we're going to do it a little bit slower, I think, this time.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and strength our hearts always hunger for. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Worthy Lord,
Almighty Infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne.
You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. God bless you all. Thank you for joining us. I'll respond to your comments in a few minutes. Have a great day and a great week, and we'll see you next time. God bless.